Now we get ourselves halfway through champ select, and we have begun with what else? A Nidalee ban against Seraph.
Oh man, of all the champions. So yeah, interestingly enough, only one ban left. Obviously, TDK has to let the timer go down all the way and not press a ban. We've already waited out the loss of ban for Gravity, as well as this will now be the second or third loss of ban for TDK. So we're very close to full-on champion select.
Yep. The pick phase starts at about 20 seconds from now. And of course, yeah, Gravity has nothing to like account for. They just plan the two out and click them right away. There's no like discussion that should be required. The Kez, Evelyn as well. Those are probably the two bans that I expect to see frequently for the rest of the TDK split, unless we start seeing other trends arise from these players. Gragas first pick though, Kez looks like he's going to get that champion with only the one jungle ban coming through.
Yeah. So what's been taking up a lot of ban space throughout the LCS week have been the double jungle bans. Generally, one team will ban Gragas, the other team will ban Rek'Sai to make sure you can't get the other. This time, since TDK had first pick, the option of a single jungle ban wasn't there for Gravity. Therefore, they end up letting both of them through, and we'll probably end up seeing Rek'Sai on the other side. Or maybe a strange pick from Move. He does play a few crazy things. This jungler who was EDG's sub last year in the OPL.
Mm-hmm.
Last split.
Well, yesterday he played Nunu for himself. We'll see if that becomes a trend he wants to continue on. Haunzer gets Hecarim. This is a champion he plays very frequently, and Bunny Fufu getting elves for every single person seems to be jumping on that hype train.
Yeah, it's real. Alistar hype train is real. So much turret diving potential at level 6. People really looking to snowball any early advantage they get. Also, a fairly teamfight heavy focused meta, and Alistar can do work in those teamfights. Pick has just kind of been on the outskirts of support play for so long, this seems to break through the wall.
Well, the crowd chance for Bard. Not going to see him this game. Sorry, guys. Vladimir picked up here. Could go to Bishu or Seraph, I suppose. Baby wants Thrash, so it looks like TDK hiding pretty much all their lane matchups. That Vlad flex pick can help them just a little bit here. Hiding AD carry in one of the solo lanes.
Yeah. So what kind of ended up happening here, because there weren't many power pick bans, one of the reasons some things are banned or picked early is because they don't really have many bad matchups, which actually makes this pick and ban phase like less strategically interesting if all they're doing is just picking the strong stuff that is good in blind pick situations.
Like Hecarim and Alistar.
And that's generally what's happened so far. Thresh, Alistar, Gragas,
yeah,
and whatever jungle Gravity wants to pick here.
Now, what does Move want to play? Altec wants Jinx here for the carry pants.
Lee Sin.
It brings up Lee Sin. One jungle ban, one jungle pick. Lee Sin coming through. I believe the second time we've seen him now this split in the NALCS.
Yeah,
that one being Smithy. Yep.
COD's victory.
True. One of the two. All right, so Gravity have saved their mid pick for last to make sure Keen can have a good matchup up against Bishu. TDK has to decide where this Vladimir actually goes. They know it's Hecarim top. They know it's Lee Sin jungle. So a very scary top lane duo for Gravity if those two champions do show up.
Definitely. I mean, Bishu could take the Vladimir mid lane as well.
It puts up a lot of easy farm matchups against him. We saw Kog'Maw do incredibly well from Incarnation in that matchup.
Keen may always want to pull out the Azir. Interesting choices here from TDK. Victor is known as a pretty good blind pick mid laner as well.
I want Astra Saver here if they go Victor.
Too bad.
Yeah, too bad. TDK not so a very mid-range focused team fight. Mid-range focused team fight comp. Vladimir, Victor, Lucian. Problem is no reliable way to start those fights. Mm-hmm. But Gravity can kind of play from a distance potentially and make life really difficult. Like this is actually lane matchup notwithstanding, kind of a good AP Kog'Maw game. They're just not going to reach you.
What about Bard mid? That would work too.
Great. Bard mid. It's AP Alistar, actually. We're pulling back to Season 1 style shoe chasing this game. And it is going to be Bard.
I'll agree with that. It's a pretty short range composition overall for TDK with a lot of damage potential. Basically, they have to play very well around Gragas and Thresh if they want to start the team fights. The one reliable initiation for TDK would be a Gragas Flash Body Slam into a knockback to the rest of the TDK team. And kind of like we saw yesterday, I feel like TDK is looking.
Oh, he is.
He wasn't lying to me.
Go.
Backstory. As casters, we have clients into the game here. He's not playing Malphite. It's probably Haunzer.
Doesn't matter. Keep going.
Yeah. We have clients to observe the game, Keen messaged me. He said, hi. As a troll, I was like, what are you going to play? He said, the champion I'm playing right now. And he was in-game as Malphite. He does mess around. Keen speaks truth.
Wanted to make a statement here. Okay, so letting all mid laners available, Bishu picks up Victor as the one he wants to play, and Keen says, how about them counterpicks? Let me play Malphite in Malphite? This matchup.
Yeah. This is actually pretty awesome for Gravity.
Yeah.
I mean, if you he pre-planned the Malphite, so I can't say, wow, he was planning this as a Victor counterpick, but honestly, Victor excels in mid-range, but is somewhat weak to things that can close into his threat window before Victor's able to touch them, and Malphite is one of those champions. AP Malphite, Unstoppable Force, can one-shot a Victor, especially when comboed with a Hecarim. So, a very devastating combo, Hecarim-Malphite.
Hecarim Malphite, the backline. There's an Alistair to help as well, by the way. Like, the amount of burst there is stupid good. I
he
feel
not
bad.
Mess around.
I feel bad for Latman now. I'm glad he's not playing Ash anymore, because he would just die right away every single time.
Ash would have been a very poor choice.
It would have been bad. Now, there's one more time for you guys to head over to Twitter and vote for who you think is going to win. Tweet at LOL Esports with your pick. Use either hashtag TDKWin or hashtag GVWin for the mid Malphite here. One of these is way more crazy.
At least if Latman would have picked Ash, he would have had Global Hawkshot.
True.
Which is, whew.
If we can see Malphite coming before Unstoppable Force kills him.
Yeah.
Now, it is worth pointing out, last time we saw mid-Malphite commonly was EULCS, and I want to say early 2014, and that was with Deathfire Grasp still as an item. So if he still goes for AP Malphite, and he's got 24 AP, so he is.
Oh, he's full AP here.
Yeah. I want to see what the build ends up being.
Yeah, I'm curious as well. Generally, AP Malphites have been Magic Pen heavy, so I'm expecting something like an Abyssal Scepter rush into Sorcerer's Shoes, or he'll go with a little bit of Mono Regen first. It's just hard to see him building in Athenes when he can go Abyssal and Burst super hard.
Yeah.
Which is what he needs to do in this game to ultimately be effective. Keen's done a few unconventional picks before they're ready. I mean, the Fizz mid he was doing, he did Abyssal Scepter Frozen Heart on mid lane Fizz when he was like super, he was the AD Fizz time, but he was still building like tank magic.
Yeah.
Mid.
It worked too.
Yeah.
It was like a high CDR tank Fizz, and he was just like stupid annoying. Bishu ran heal this game, which is surprising to me. I think he'd have to expect Ignite mid, right, from the AP Malphite. I feel like heal's just not good against Ignite when you have things like Barrier exhaust.
I do like the fact that Bishu has gone a defensive summoner.
Absolutely.
On Victor, I'm a big fan of double defensive summoner on the really high sustained damage mid lane mages like Cassiopeia, Azir, and Victor fits in that club as well.
Mm-hmm.
At least against Malphite, Barrier is probably a pretty good choice. Because you can use it right as the ult too. That's the choice. Heal, a little bit more utility, but he will be vulnerable to that Ignite, as you said.
Well, we'll see how it ends up playing out. Should be some fun things happening. So a lane swap coming in, by the way. Seraph is 1v1ing up against all tech right now. Buddy people will be joining in. Move and Hauncer are double jungling. Blue buff did go to Lee Sin. I'm actually surprised at that. They didn't give it away to Hauncer.
Yeah, double smite jungling as well. So Hauncer for the slightly late gamer tanky headroom. With the double jungle, I'll be interested to see how Seraph can keep up an experience here. It's a dangerous world. Didn't have to burn his teleport to get to lane, though, so as long as he doesn't get all in, he can keep this up. And they're trying desperately to get their support here before they'd be able to get ganked. But if it's a four-man gank, they'd actually need three people under the turret to stop it successfully.
That's true. Right now, though, they didn't manage to freeze Gravity in the top lane. So Seraph is getting experience, it seems, for the most of this. Actually, no, I take it back. Looks like it did freeze. There's a slight minion lead here. And Baby's going to show up to support. Vladimir should be fairly safe then, unless Hauncer and Move go crazy. They get Scuttler, but they get spotted by the ward. And Move's alone over here. Deep Trinket to try to track Kez.
Yeah, I think it's a good strategy by Gravity to do this lane swap against TDKO as a sub-squad. If anything is remarkably different than the solo queue game and competitive, it is the world of lane swaps. It's almost like playing a different game. So it's basically now on Kez and Seraph to just really quickly teach TDK on all the things they need to do to not fall prey to common lane swap tactics like a four-man dive, which honestly Baby did fairly well. He made it to lane pretty quick. He then placed defensive wards, which would give them heavy advanced warning of a four-man dive, and Gravity ends up not going for it.
All right, so looks like we just have awkward 2-on-2s all the same. Hecarim did teleport in. Haunter, by the way, as you mentioned in the jungling time, Smite teleport Hecarim, so we will see challenging Smite Cinderhulk out of that guy, most likely. 1v1ing this Latman Lucian. I wonder how many times he's actually 1v1 to Hecarim in solo queue, and I'm going to guess not many times.
Yeah, these guys were on Frank Fan Gaming as well, though, so they have...
Yeah.
I shouldn't say they're straight out of solo queue. That's true.
They're a pretty successful challenger team.
Yeah, so they definitely have done this before. It's just on an LCS level, sometimes it's a little bit different, but they're dealing quite well with this.
Keen actually doing reasonably well in this matchup against Bishu, slowly chunking health down. Potions for the victor. Nice try.
Oh, they're trying to track the projectile. Too slow, observers. Pfft. Try next time.
Yeah, great.
Completely unnecessary.
It's good. It's the day of smack talk. I like
now
it.
Now every champion I talk about will just be off screen.
Man, Alistar mid's so cool, right, guys?
Yeah.
Yeah!
Hi, Alistar.
Even the players are helping.
Yeah, this early game from the mid lane Malphite, pretty standard spell build for the solo lane Malphite. Max in Q and then E, no points in W because you just want to maximize your burst damage here. Also, he's got a decent range trade there. Bishu, early on in the game, can't really break through the passive shield of Malphite at the moment. So Keen's happily farming on this mid Malphite. Nicely done.
Yeah, until he gets some mana regen, you can't easily spam E to push Keen around. So you're right, breaking the passive, nearly impossible for him. Right now, Altec has been swapped back to the bottom lane with a pickaxe.
Yeah, Latman's returned after his projectile, according to the observers, disappeared. So no one could follow that. So they claim.
Okay.
Yeah, honestly, though, it's a pretty big XP edge for Latman. He had a lot of free time down in that bottom lane to get this 36 or so CS. Not as much farm, but a little bit more experience because he was 1v1. It's going to be on Haunter now to try and not fall behind since the lanes have swapped back, and he will be against Seres Vladimir, who's going to be turning on pretty quick.
Absolutely. He got a little bit of time to get some experience in a roughly safe lane. Has a minion lead as well, level 5 on the Vladimir. No real threatening items from Haunter. He's actually not even recalled to buy anything yet. A deep ward. Smart by Haunter. Gets it over the wall towards Gromp. Very common for top laners, but good to see that continue to proliferate among all these top laners here. Kez gets spotted as he takes down the Scuttle Crab, and Haunter is going to be in this one-on-one. Should be safe against this Gragas. Luv getting some time to counter jungle
they
on Lee.
They really want
to
dive Bishu.
They know Kez is fairly close by. They saw him take down Scuttle.
Are they going to get in as soon as Kez walks around the corner? No,
Kez
they're calling it off.
Okay. Ooh, and he loses the Raptor buff too from that ward in the brush. So small loss there. Level 6 Latman Lucian.
Yeah.
Has been playing his lanes fairly passively. Did the same against the Team Liquid dual lane as well.
That's true. Had a good early gank in that game from Kez, but with the lane swap in this one, it cut down on the creativity they could do because they're trying to just keep up with Gravity's lane swapping. Interesting picking the Lee Sin into the Gragas as well.
Yeah.
I'm much more okay with the Lee Sin pick in this context than I would be if they were up against one of the other tank junglers. Basically, one of the reasons Gragas has been so dominant is he is one of the tank junglers that still provides so much early game pressure.
Yeah.
But Lee Sin can match that early game pressure. And unlike someone like a Sejuani, who's a huge monster in like super late game team fights, Gragas does have like a 40-minute fall off where he will provide the utility of the ultimate, but won't be doing a huge amount of damage. And Lee Sin follows a somewhat similar path where he can pull off the initiation. And he's still able to get tanky if he goes for it. So it's not as mismatched late game as some of the other matchups would be.
Yeah, you're right about that one. Right now, though, it is, if we haven't mentioned this yet, Warrior Lee Sin, so he'll be squishy for a while. Has actually bought regular old green wards, so still spending some money on that one. Also went Trailblazer, so not a combat smite either. Kind of interesting to see moves choices here. We'll keep him full health almost the entire time through the jungle so that he can gank with a decent enough health bar and not have to spend too much money on potions. Second recall for Latman. He ulted the wave and then backed for an Avarice Blade, so trying to bank up money for a while. Happy to play a bit of a slower game and just money, money, money for a while. Keen got his blue buff. Looks like he's going towards Abyssal after all. That's what the Blasting Wand should be for here.
Yeah, because of the Avarice, though, Altec will have enough for a BS Sword. That could sway that lane pretty heavily if they end up trading. So Gravity is kind of slowly pulling ahead in some of these lanes. And so much respect has to be given to Keen's AP Malphite here, coming back with the Blasting Wand already. Any opportunity, he might go.
Whoa, whoa! Yeah, well, good timing, Jack. Good flash by Bishu. Gets away from Move's Q, though. Double Summoner's use, heal use as well. Ulti from Altec. Oh! What? Track of their sway, observers. It went off the screen. They missed another projectile.
Right there. Oh, man. I believe the ward probably gave him a little bit of an advanced warning as it came through.
Orkaz yelling, oh, God, rocket, dodge it.
He does so. Interesting there. The fact that Keen flashed in for his Unstoppable Force instead of just going for it. He would have been in range for a max range one, but he decided to try and make it more instantaneous so it wouldn't get flashed immediately. Mm-hmm. Which technically successful, it's just they can't come up with the kill.
Ooh, good hook by Baby. Altec going to get pulled almost into turret range. But look at that damage from Latman. Gets one crit from the Avarice Blade on the attacks over there. Altec quite low on the end of it all. Bunny Fufu buying a bit of time. Time to regen.
Yeah, Move's still going to try and make a play there. Couldn't get his ultimate off yet, and they have already swept here.
They don't know there aren't wards in that brush.
With Bunny Fufu at level 6, the dive becomes a very real possibility.
This is frozen right in front of the turret. Like, this is going to be so hard for them to dive this. Seraph has teleport for a counter gank. Han's going to play aggressively. Challenging Smite used as well, and Seraph is getting a fair bit of health.
Nice harass there by Landman.
Yeah. Has come in to show up top as well, is seen by a ward, and now Gravity knows there is no Gragas counter gank available. If they go for the bot lane, Altec losing more health though, getting heavily worn down by Latman.
Yeah, that's two or three piercing lights in a row the Latman has been able to weave through the minion while getting the last hit and hit Altec. Really getting good harass out considering he's down a BF sword essentially in trading by getting that poke in with the piercing light that Altec can't trade back.
Yeah, absolutely impressive. You pick Lucian primarily, I would say, 70% for the laning phase, and that is something he's doing quite well. Move gets the smite steal, loses the buff to a nearby ward, but still getting the raptor away from Bishu is quite nice. Keen does still nurse a small minion lead in this 1v1 match. The mid Malphite is winning lane against Victor, someone we typically consider a strong laner. So, so far so good from mid AP Malphite, to be completely fair. The rotation of the mid lane, Gravity do call something aggressive, and this is going to lose a lot of health.
Yeah, Malphite's also a pretty strong laner as well, as we're seeing early shield just off of Malphite's passive, making it difficult to trade, as well as his actual trading with the max in his Seismic Shard is pretty big. Oh, hello, Hanser.
And the team is coming in soon. Flame by Baby does not really stop the damage. Hanser in with the box, moves around. Teleport for Seraph as well. Latman out of mana, he won't do much. A kick knocks back Baby. Moves forced out though. First Blood goes in. The rocket from Altec now to join the fight. Nice dash by Latman. Gets away from Bunny Fufu. Seraph gonna puddle out as well. Kez to ditch them all back and a one for one.
Yeah, all five members were coming down there. The mid laners are ready to join as well. But yeah, it is just a one for one. Move seemed to disappear right there. No defensive stats whatsoever so far in his build. You can really see the squishiness coming through right there as he got blown up. But I would say advantage Gravity out of that trade because Altec got the kill for himself, whereas Baby as a support will not be able to make as good use of that kill gold.
Yeah, even though it was first blood for TDK, so like technically more gold earned, I agree with you. The correct person got that money. Keen now getting harassed around a little bit. Doesn't seem to care anyway. Chugging away on that flask and being nice and happy. That's the second death ray in a row, though. This harass is starting to add up.
And critically, it was before Keen could let his shield refresh, so it did the full amount of damage. And now Keen basically just has to go back to base.
He can afford Abyssal Scepter.
Or so just wait for his health to come back up.
That's true. I do think getting Abyssal, maybe after this wave, is worth doing, though. It is a pretty important item to spike up with. Seraph looks like he's got a plenty of pushing power right now against Hanser. Cinderhulk done on the Hecarim. No teleport for either top laner. Dragon, of course, is back up now. Looks like the team's not protesting it very heavily. Seraph actually starting to go pretty hard on Hanzo. Yeah, out he goes. Yeah. 400 health left.
Yeah, Seraph at that critical level 9 for Vladimir. Able to vamp up so heavily already with that Will of the Ancients, but just a Cinderhall completed by Haunter, so no magic resistance. It's a really big power spike at the moment for Seraph before Haunter can get the MR. And he gets that null magic right away, and he's going to need to fly back to that lane to save the turret.
Well, no home guards because no upgraded boots yet. Haunter's not going to fly back too quickly, unfortunately. Second time in a row, we're seeing Seraph seemingly winning his lane, at least in minion score.
Yeah, well, he was absolutely decimating people in the Challenger Series.
Yeah.
Like, the Seraph that was on CLG is much different than the Seraph that we're seeing now for, you know, a number of ways. Whether it's experience, he has also improved as a player, but just the environment he has in TDK, this is his team, he's not on someone else's team. And it reflects in his play, even in the Challenger Series, and two games in a row now in the LCS, winning his lane.
Challenging Smite in the dash once more. Haunter really trying to push Seraph around and actually chunking him down to half HP, but guess what? It's Will the Ancients, Vladimir. I don't know how long you keep him really down for. But Haunter does make some progress off this one. TP's still 2.5 minutes away on this one. Latman gonna push around Altec. Decent damage dealt, actually. Dragon still on the table. Both teams starting, looks like now to really put some wards down. Gravity, a lot of defensive pink wards, and now a couple of aggressive green ones. Still only single sight stone, though.
Interesting rotation here by Gravity, though, coming underneath the turrets. Really just a nice rotation to pick themselves up a nice uncontested turret.
Very well done. All right, so, oh, wow, the flash engage. Hello. They find Baby. In comes Hecarim. How about that for decisiveness? Kez to knock a few back, but still a 1-for-0 off that turret kill.
Wow, so normally we try and prep these team fights because we can see the rotations and we know when a team's about to engage. Keen's engagement range is huge. It's about 2,000 range because both times he's flash alted to go in for it. They very quickly pick up a kill on a baby and try and rotate for the dragon, but because so much was invested, you can see TDK trying to take turrets and then he pushes on the other side.
Doing what they can to push it. Of course, there's not a lot of wave through on this gravity lineup. Even Jinx is not great at it at this stage of the game. So maybe pushing can go well. Seraph once again looking for a fight onto Haunter. A lot of transfusions used. Not quite going to get it. And he refuses to Sanguine Pool.
He was saving it in case he really needed it, yeah. As all Vladimir should.
True. Kez gets a buff steal in the same time. They realize where move was and that no one could help that one. So TDK making the best of that situation. You said take some objectives. Got the red buff, not too bad. Nice hook on the ward. Bunny Fufu not going to feel good about this one. And the flay backwards as he's brought in Latman to help.
It's a long way home for Bunny Fufu. He does have his flash. That's all he wants to do.
And the ult bottom enough time. Hook's not going to land. Nice try, though.
Yeah, they managed to burn some nice summoners there just for a good back disruption. This will also give them freedom to push up the lane where Altec is already coming back to it. So overall, solid play by TDK. And honestly, just, they're down 2 dragons, but because of the turret lead, this is a winnable game here for TDK and their 3 subs.
It absolutely is. These guys are up 1,000 gold over Gravity right here. Gravity, their week in basically consisted of playing the 2 newcomers to the North American LCS with one of the more changed returning rosters of the NA teams. In fact, I guess with 2 replacements, it's the most changed of the NA LCS rosters of the returning teams. So kind of the newest teams in a way, the ones matching up here in TDK, actually getting the better of Gravity, much like NME was.
Yeah, looking to be another close game for Gravity.
Definitely.
Which we're gonna have to see now. No St. Vicious, no Cop, or the shot calling in the middle of the game. How can they make moves and make big plays? Oh boy.
That Chomper was big. The Headbelt Pulverize helping as well. That Lantern would have saved them, but a misstep by Latman means the kill comes in to Bunny Fufu. Altec getting a second assist. Bot lane turret goes down. Gravity turning it right back around now.
Yeah. Don't step on the Chomper. Bad to do against Jinx and duels right there. So Latman ends up paying heavily for this one. And now the ultimate is up from Keen's Malphite. They might look to go.
Man. Yeah, every time he's on screen, I'm just like, is someone going to die in the next 2 seconds? Oftentimes, that answer is yes.
He's got an assist, but it's okay. Always really close.
Yeah.
Potential is there. I feel it.
The health bar gets smaller at the very least.
He almost killed Ishii there.
We missed it, but you know what? It's okay, Observers. I forgive you.
We'll get a replay. Maybe. It wasn't a kill, so maybe it's not worth it. He did not burn his Ignite, but he burned the heal from Bishu.
All right, heal for Malphite ulti. No CDR on Malphite. He does go Abyssal Sword Shoes and... yeah, none of that mana regen stuff. Well, double Doran's Ring, I guess, was his mana regen of choice. My mind said Chalice, but Keen knows better than I do. Double Doran's Ring was the build. Mid lane turret still taking damage. Wow, Seraph without MR takes a fair bit of damage from those Qs. But this turret very nearly dead. Keen's wave clear, not great.
Yeah, definitely not if you can't get a melee range for the ground slam. Just thinking of these team compositions as they progress too. Oh great, we got the replay.
Hoorah!
Because of the heal, all the spells are gone for Keen, and he can't chase through the gravity field. But that's the burst level. So basically Keen either needs more burst or an assistant to come with him on his unstoppable force journeys. Or even just a Jinx rocket would have been able to do it. But it's clearly not 100-0 from the Malphite, but it's close.
Yeah.
Also, you can see the Distortion Boots bot already.
Nice.
For more Flash Ultimates. It is a thing, especially we have very low ping environments and very fast reaction times from our pro players here. So the fast Unstoppable Force from max range is a very flashable spell. It's much less flashable if you basically flash on top of someone and then use your ultimate. So almost like an Alistar Pulverize that does more damage is basically what Keen is doing. This team now has two Alistar Pulverizes, or two Malphite ults, depending on how you want to look at it.
I tend to think like Alistar WQ is like more like an Unstoppable Force. I'm gonna say it's more like Malphite ult, just one is like way less damage. Either way, definitely a scary lineup here. Haunter's ulti even somewhat similar, right? Pick an area, they all get feared instead of knocked up. Three ways to click an area and stun a bunch of people. That man dealing with move a little bit here, but the top lane getting pressured by a fair number of the gravity members. All tech and Bunny Fufu doing what they can for turret demolition. Latman wave clears a bit. Move comes in, goes for the flash. A flash wave baby gets over the wall. But Keen is around with the ulti from Malphite. Does he even want to use it? The answer is no, because Latman's still around. Wow, more come in. Haunter picks up one. And gravity, gotta be careful. Bishu turns one back around. It's a 2-for-1 in gravity's favor, though, as they look to limp away from this one.
Keen still has his ultimate if he wants to turn it. So they're using this for a bit of pressure. It was a nice start to the fight there by Gravity, rotating through the jungle right there with all the smattering of wards. Basically, the amount of pressure Mu was able to create by jumping in there was enough to close it. Now, here comes the dive. Maybe a Malphite to follow.
Bit of damage on Kez, bit of damage on Seraph, but Seraph really unperturbed at all. He's going to have a ton of damage put down to this one. No ulti for himself, but they force back Bunny Fufu. Seraph's going to live through the ignite. Keen goes in towards Bishu, but as we mentioned before, he needs a helper for that to work. The ulti wasted doing no damage. Out they go.
It felt like Keen kept waiting for the perfect moment to use Unstoppable Force, but TDK just wasn't giving it to him. So finally, at the end of the day, he uses it on something that would never result in a kill. Keen really just not going for the easy Malphite ultimate that wasn't perfect and ends up wasting it and then having to burn his flash as a runaway skill. So
yeah.
Ultimately, Gravity does benefit from that, though, mainly because of Move's nice start.
And TDK managed to answer back, though, off those the ill-fated second attempt dive, and mid lane outer turret does go down, so TDK up 3 turrets to 2 in this one. But as everyone heals back up, Dragon 3 is on the table for Gravity. It spawned now. And Move has a couple of deep wards to help him clear this away. TDK, though, wanted to answer the ward control right back.
Yeah, and Bishu's in the midst of a pretty big power spike right now. Having his death cap completed, he hits like an absolute truck. But his summoners and ultimate are down, so he's a little bit vulnerable right now.
Oh, no.
Move falling behind and still squishy. Who's going to go in for this Dragon? The ultimates just aren't there for the majority of the teams.
TDK is around. Dragon's still at 2,000 health. They're going to go in for the attempt. The smite for Kez going to knock actually Leeson in, but still picked up a good body slam flash, and Move's got nowhere to go. Picked up by Latman. 3 kills now for TDK. They're within 500 gold now.
We talked in Champion Select about initiation from TDK and how it may not be the most reliable, but the one reliable thing they would have would be the flash body slam from Kez. That's what they do right there to secure the kill onto Move after they were able to take the Dragon, and now TDK looking to use that power spike from Victor and the initiation that is on a 5-minute cooldown from their jungler in the flash body slam to create a bigger opportunity. They go for the turret, Gravity defense.
We'll see if Gravity can defend this one. 4v5, Move is just now respawned and walking over. Altec, the soul wave clear, doing the best he can to remove these minions, does okay, and a static shift helps as well. Keen looking for the flank attempt, Move's nearby. Can they land it?
The respect is very real from TDK. They don't, more importantly than just stopping the Malphite, TDK is trying to stop the backup for the Malphite.
Yeah.
So these fights are very interesting because based on the team compositions, TDK needs to be very spread out. The actual circle of power for Malphite and Hecarim is a small radius.
Yeah.
So as long as TDK spreads out, Gravity has difficulty womboing all three of their very small circle ultimates that they have in there. In order to make a really good play here, Gravity will have to manipulate the Fog of War very well and hopefully somehow funnel TDK through a choke.
Yeah.
Or they'll just get a super fed Jinx in the late game and crush it.
Well, that's true. There's definitely a lot of powerful win conditions for Gravity, and yet knocking turrets down very easy for a big Jinx. Gravity sitting on a 2,000 gold lead are in the driver's seat right here. TDK, though, I have seen so many games of them being behind, and then Seraph just goes and just destroys everybody by himself. He's stacked a bunch of armor. He wants to be able to survive Hanser. He's going for a Luden's Echo. And now Latman forced to run away from Hanser.
Now Hanser still trying to power up. The Cinderhulk Ekrem takes a little bit longer to get super strong. Can still do some work with the Cinderhulk, but he's not going to be one-shotting Latman by any stretch of the imagination. I am interested in the Aether Wisp there by Seraph as well, though. Probably, as you said, Luden's Echo.
Yeah.
Going in for Vladimir. Just building on anybody at this point.
And he gets to run faster during Sanguine Pool. And he has very low cooldown, so you're going to stack that up reasonably quickly.
Yeah, I've seen it in a few different situations. Interesting to forego. A lot of times you'll see the Zhonya's, and then you almost immediately want to get into either Magic Resist or Magic Pen. Sometimes Abyssal serves both of those niches. A lot of physical damage coming through, though. Malphite's not going to be ulting him, so Seraph doesn't have a need to get the magic resistance in this game, and he just wants to do a whole bunch of damage. Zhonya's, and unless a Malphite's ulting him, he doesn't need to immediately Zhonya's for any high bits of damage. So with those things in mind, Seraph's build choice is actually pretty cool right there, trying to go for Luden's and absolutely maximizing his DPS while minimizing more defensive capabilities.
150 armor, 1,800 health. That's one of the tankier champions on the map. I mean, for reference, 2,300 health on Hanser, and he's built practically full tank with that Cinderhulk. Not the hugest disparity. We'll see as time goes on.
It's funny. Certain targets will need magic resistance against the Malphite, but that is the only real magic damage threat coming from that entire team. So if you're a target that you think is immune to the full burst from Malphite, Seraph's doing a very wise thing, because if Keen does ult him, A, he could reaction it with a pool of blood and completely shut it down. And B, even if he dies to it, maybe TDK wins the fight anyway, because
that's
that
true.
Means Victor is safe to just do a bunch of damage.
Yeah, I totally agree, Jack. It's going to be fun seeing what Seraph can do with this one. We don't see a lot of top lane Vladimir. A lot of people hate on the champion. The lack of mobility summoners, often referred to as the core weakness, that he can't get through those team fights and do the things he wants to do. Luden's Echo, I guess maybe an adaptation to help cover the fact that he's not running Ghost because he's running Teleport.
Gotta go fast.
Gotta go fast as Vladimir. Any of those mid-range mages tend to need some help getting to the targets they want. Same could be said for Bishu's Victor here. He chose to run heal. Does give some mobility. Gravity right now playing slightly better in the vision game. They are controlling Baron. And as Dragon spawns in 2 minutes, you might see them control that some more as well.
Yeah, there's a distinct lack of wards in the Dragon area right now because Baron is receiving the majority of the ward attention. I really think the team that gets the ward around Dragon first could hold a big pick edge here. Whether it be Kez, whose flash is going to be back up for his body slam initiation, or Keen, who may finally get off that one ultimate. He has two real targets. He's want to go on Victor or Lucian. I feel like Victor is the biggest one at this point. If Keen can get his unstoppable force on a Bishu and anyone can follow up on him so they can burst him down before he gets right damage off, that's Gravity's key to winning a team fight.
We'll see if he can land those initiations then. Gravity's key is going to be important here. It's only a 1,000 gold disparity, much like Gravity's game yesterday against Enemy Esports. It's a very close game where the right choice will win you the battle. And with Gravity playing a bunch of backline divers, the coordination between Hanser and Keen was actually very crucial. And them not getting Otter together was part of the reason they had actually lost that game to Enemy Esports. And now they've got a very scary Bishu, a pretty scary Latman, a pretty scary Seraph. Which of these threats do you coordinate onto? As you talk about the key is to their engagements, Gravity, you need to choose well. Luden's Echo done onto Seraph. I feel like he's going to be such a threat. Hanser just does not have any real magic resist. Thankfully, Move does have an Aegis to help protect from that somewhat in a team fight.
Pretty mirrored strategies here. Trinkets are exactly the same across the board.
Yeah.
With the mid turret already down, though, Gravity's hoping that they get a they have Homeguard Teleport that can come in as well. Gravity might look to flank this one. Here we go.
Choppers are down. TP coming in from the Hecarim. Hook's not quite going to land, but Move takes a ton of damage. But there comes the engage.
They got Bishu.
The wobbles on top of everybody. Bishu does get eliminated without getting to ult, flash, heal, or anything. Latman trying to run away. Bunny Fufu in the front lines has lost the ult. The Ignite is on, and the Alistar looks like he will just barely live. Latman gets a shutdown on a Hecarim. A bunch of kills for TDK, despite the fact that Bishu went down. A 3-for-1.
They got Bishu, and therefore they were not able to get anyone else. Seraph did so much work in that fight with that Luden's Echo and his Vladimir, just going through everyone else as Bishu was caught up in the unstoppable storm of Malphite. Really interesting right there. Bunny Fufu took so much damage before the fight, they completely tunneled onto Bishu. And yes, Bishu was the key to the fight before gravity, but they used everything on him. Left all tech to just have to run away, and TDK, they were the ones who played that fight just right.
Yes, they were. So the multiple threats, he could only delete one. The other two took over. Seraph, 1-0-2. Latman, 2-2-4. We can watch this engage one more time.
Yeah, so Bunny Fufu's low at the start. Move gets chunked before he can do anything. And then, yeah, three people do the flash in, and then the Alistar doesn't peel Seraph off whatsoever. So basically, Seraph pushes them completely off the fight, meaning Malphite already used his damage. Hecarim's a tank. Alistar's a tank. Who is there to actually kill the other threat in Latman once they blow him up? Nobody, because no one was peeling for alt tech and he couldn't get in the backside. Yeah. So the battle lines didn't exist for gravity right there. All dive, no protection, and TDK wins with superior team fight placement.
Yeah, really good team fight placement overall. And it's interesting to see that Alistar was in fact used as an offensive engage tool in that fight. You pick Jinx, a pretty, you know, bad self-peeling champion, on the spectrum there, with a team that's going to dive on in. No one's going to keep her alive. Smart choice by Seraph. Zoned her out by himself. Good job, Seraph. And then Clean Up Crew was quite nice. Okay.
Yeah, think of it another way. They used Malphite all on top of itself. You don't need to do that. You don't need to knock them up twice if you're going to instantly kill them. Bunny Fufu, unless they can get the whole team in those knockups, needs to be back and helping out Altec a little bit. This gives TDK a window to try and come back now. Especially because when Bishu got blown up, he didn't even use the summoners. So he has them this time if he can actually react to flash something.
Yeah, we'll see if he can do it. He's got distortion boots himself, actually. Bishu looking to match those flashes sometimes. Invested in this one. Righteous Glory pop. Bishu takes a lantern out. Now Kez the man close to the rest of the team. Monster cannot find the engage, though. Move's a very squishy champion, by the way, in this Lee Sin. He's at under 2,000 health. He's got the lock. He's got the Sight Stone. It's all utility for him.
I really thought when he was picking the Lee Sin against Gragas, he'd be going for Cinderhulk here. Especially just late game utility-wise, he's going to be taking far too much damage by going Warrior, and that's what we're seeing in a lot of these team fights. Is he's blowing up and not really able to have any use. Aside from that one nice double kill he forced in the top lane, it's been a lot of Move just getting chunked immediately and having to run away.
Yeah, TDK has a lot of ambient AoE damage. If it was like a bunch of assassins, like maybe I'd understand because like Zed won't ever hit him, but Seraph's going to press E, that'll deal damage. Kez on Gragas is going to tend to do that. Bishu can oftentimes land his E as well, and Latman, not really a waste of time to kill Lee Sin in a team fight, so you're right, easy to kind of hit Move in these battles. And right now, though, Gravity's still feeling like they can try to control Baron. They force the scrying orb usage. Now Seraph getting a bit surrounded. He's very much by himself. Nice chain CC. Never gets a chance to Sanguine Pool unless he predicted the headbutt. Nicely done by Gravity. They've got some room to make some plays.
Yeah, now they can actually kind of force onto this Baron because there's no Seraph to zone off the Altec in an actual fight. Let's see if Keen gets in range. Really nice kiting so far by TDK. Gravity not able to pull the trigger. They have a small window here, 20 seconds until Seraph can teleport in.
22 seconds now. Kez going to put another lantern on down. Altec not hitting Baron much. Now he goes in for this one. Hanser taking a bit of damage to the backside. Latman gets hit. There's the flash pulverize and a headbutt. Down he goes in the Keen backline and dive. Looks for Bishu. Gets the fear, but not yet the kill. Kez flashes the wall. More chase coming through. Chaos Storm only deters, doesn't kill. 2-for-0 overall.
Yet no Baron for Gravity, but they still played that one quite well. You could see the mid-game learnings they picked up right there. Let's space out our ultimates a little bit. One for Latman, the other one for Bishu. Keen doesn't fully kill him, but at least he takes him out of the fight. They can then take down the AD carry, and one kill kind of snowballed into the other. That was never going to be a Baron for Gravity. That was all about the fight right afterwards because they have so much initiation potential. This time they spaced out a little bit better and got some kills.
All right, so the extra pickup on Illusion buys them some time. A big wave top lane gets cleared by Altec. He's sitting at 364 minions. That is a fed Jinx. I mean, she is online and ready to kill champions. The bot lane had went to Seraph, though. These guys, you can see them kind of putting their farm in different places. Lehman getting a fair amount of CS, but Altec is getting so much more. It was one of his best traits on Winterfox, that Altec was always able to find so much farm in these long games, typically hitting 10 CS a minute as an AD carry, which we don't see that often.
Yeah, one of Altec's biggest strengths, for sure. There's that farm. If Seraph wasn't caught out in that situation, so obviously a mistake by Seraph, being in that place, Gravity needs to continue to find catches like that if they don't want to lose to this TDK team. It'd be pretty remarkable for TDK to be a challenger team to qualify for the LCS, to have your roster not even here, just pick up three players and then have Seraph and Kez get a win in the LCS.
I mean, they put a close game up against Team Liquid, a team very well regarded, defending third place from NALCS in spring. That was close from TDK for a while. This one certainly very close up against Gravity. I mean, it looks like this lineup can absolutely compete with some of these, as players have called it, mid-tier teams.
They're competing right now with Gravity. And Gravity's another team we need to get some more time to judge where they'll rank in the NALCS here. These two roster moves, that's a lot removed from the team without St. Vicious and Kopp on the battlefield with them. St. Vicious gone completely. Kopp now a coach, helping with picks and bans. Yeah, an incredibly close game. This is where Gravity and honestly TDK, both teams need to have that mid-game shot call. The scaling from the Victor and the Vladimir is pretty immense, whereas Move is only going to be getting weaker and weaker. Keen, unless he's one-shotting, isn't doing much sustained damage. It's putting a lot of weight on Haunter and Altec's shoulders from Gravity.
Well, Altec's used to trying to be one of the big primary damage sources for his team. He kind of had that role with Winterfox to a certain extent. We said on Gravity, you know, can you prove that you are one of these top AD carries?
Oh, wow.
Yeah, wow, okay, well, Funny People did not even, didn't think he needed it, got destroyed, TDK. Now the team with the advantage, they're gonna get Dragon off that.
That's that late game Victor damage for you. Bunny Fufu not respecting it, no magic resistance on him because of the Righteous Glory. Could have lived, but he would have been pushed off the Dragon regardless. Here, at least Bishu's ultimate is down, but now Gravity's put in a really difficult bind as TDK looks to force this.
Yeah.
No flash body slam for the initiation, but they still have the normal body slam and a Vladimir.
Let's flash see. Play, Altec gonna get nothing happening to him. Seraph loses half his health, still no MR. Keen does so much damage, forced to pool early. Hans are getting hit up right now. In goes Keen to the backline, still can't find Seraph. Looks for Bishu, can't get him either. The dodging away, and down goes Keen in the over-aggression. Move kicks them all backwards. Now Altec to carry the fight. Good dodge by Baby. Stops the reset that Jinx could have used to kill off Latman right afterwards.
Sometimes these games can come down to a pixel. That sidestep by Baby could have been two or three kills for Altec if he got excited and chased after a few more kills. Even so, Gravity looking to turn something out of nothing here. Seraph could always teleport back in. This is a risk. This is a big risk.
Huge risk off the recall, but I think they can do it. TP comes in now from Seraph. Over the wall, it's going to be the disengage. Gravity still missing their mid laner for 10 more seconds. TDK are the stronger team on the map right now. They take the Scuttler. They don't get rid of all the wards, but now maybe they start bear.
Yeah.
Attempt number 18.
Back and forth and back again. One of these days, someone's going to get it. Altec a little bit low on mana. There's three
a lot of
that
Gravity's
can't come in. Haunter's going to home guard in. That's all they're going to have, though. Altec and a horse.
TP started. They knock Kez right into the bear pit. He's down to 1,000 health. Bunny Fufu forced to flash away. He's already popped his own ulti. Haunter on the one side move there as well. TDK back to disengaging. The Baron baits just turned into damage dealt and recalls afterwards. Move, be careful.
This is kind of the game we were expecting.
Yep.
We didn't expect incredibly decisive play over Vectors, but everybody wants this one thing. Eventually, someone will get that thing. It's Baron. TDK trying to defend this one.
Keen ult is up in about 10, or like 3 seconds right now. 4,000 HP on Baron. Kez in the back wall. Keen flashes in. He goes for the engage. They find Bishu. Move gets the kill. Altec versus Seraph. Knocked back by Kez. This side of the fight's going well for Gravity. Baby, the third kill picked up. Seraph nearly gone. Kez and Seraph is trying to get away from this one. It's already been a 4-for-1. Kez goes down. Oh. Seraph gonna drop to Hanser. That's the ace, and Gravity have control.
The ambient damage from Hanser right there interrupted Seraph's back, and then he able to walk into the brush and finish him at the end of that one. Altec additionally pushing away on Jinx, and finally some movement in the goal differential this game. Gravity with the ace and the long 38-minute death timers are taking a ton of stuff here.
Baron picked up mid lane inhibitor turret and inhibitor itself. They get Baron buff. Oh god, okay. Onto Bunny Fufu as well. He just respawned, so a 5-man Baron and a whole ton of map control right now. They might even get top turret. Jeez, that's a lot of damage.
Yeah, Trinity Force, level 18, and Baron on Hecarim. Yeah, we're gonna have to see that one again to really figure out exactly what happened, because the fight was spread out so far. I think the main thing is Altec just stayed alive and actually was able to win the duel against Seraph, which meant he could continue on the rest of the fight. But tracking the ultimate cooldowns throughout this entire thing, you can't honestly track all of these things at once. So Seraph goes in for Altec, but this time, watch, Bunny Fufu is actually peeling off for him on the side. Headbutt pulverizes Seraph down, and then allows Altec to stay alive. Doesn't get that one.
Oh,
my God,
30 health
fight. Meanwhile, on the backside, because so much attention was put into trying to finish Altec, this time Gravity takes it down on the other side. It's crazy to figure out exactly what happened there.
Bishu got one shot, and Seraph was zoned away, not actually quite killing Altec, so Latman was just a formality to clean up at that point. Good fight by Gravity, a lot gained by these guys, and 5,000 and a half gold lead, plus 2 minutes left of Baron buff. Gravity can do a lot of work here.
Very big Bunny Fufu as well. Iron Elixir, everyone able to dive in after. But it's still about that crisp execution of the dive. There is now a Negatron Cloak on to Bishu. So this will be interesting. The split push is nice by Gravity. By keeping this here, they make it so a damage dealing threat has to be away from the main squad, which makes the assassination of the Malphite stronger.
Yeah, it does. And it's going to mean that TDK gives up bot lane tier 2. All the turrets outside the base have been killed. Gravity making those bricks tumble to the ground. Mid lane inhibitor still dead. Hecarim still split pushing the top lane. He's going to rotate back on over.
The attempts at TDK and Gravity chance. And then TSM just for...
Because always.
Just for fun.
It's North America, guys.
Yeah, honestly, one inhibitor down, Baron buff, Bunny Fufu is huge. You can dive with an ulted Alistar quite well. So this turret's actually not as safe as it would be. Bunny Fufu got turret aggro.
Look for Kez a little bit as well. Bunny Fufu, yeah, taking a ton of damage. In comes the team to the back line. They don't quite get anything at the start. Flash Pulverize still does not find kills, and Gravity stuck inside the base. One kill picked up for Bishu. The turret does go down. Is there counter engage? Oh, wow, Keen gets one. Altec misses, but they get a second just the same. A 2-for-1 into the base they go. Second inhib will go down. Gravity with a numbers lead, but Sarah has something to say about that one. Takes a million and a half damage. They try to re-engage back at Altec. The hook on a Hanser, he might go down. Move is squishy, but they can't get the damage onto him just yet.
Oh!
In goes, picks up Latman. Wow! A move makes an LCS big play at the end of that one, and now Altec is here to clean up the base with Hanser. Seraph needs home guards to try to defend this one. Heals back up, but can he defend the game in time? Brings Altec to half. Pop Sanguine Pool. Here comes the hook as well. It's gonna be close. Seraph gets one. He looks for number two, trying to knock down Keen. Move still around, though, and gets the Nexus. GG for Gravity.
42 minutes of fury this was between Gravity and TDK. You asked if there was counter-engage at the end. Yes, there was a lot of counter engage.
Yes.
Malphite finally found the right ultimate. Keen waiting so long in all of these fights to get the right Malphite ultimate off, and he finally does to just blow some people up on TDK. It wasn't pretty.
Nope.
But it counts.
It definitely does count. So, TDK, so far this roster, bringing games very close against veteran teams Liquid and Gravity. Gravity, a tough, hard-fought loss over Enemy Esports yesterday, a tough, hard-fought win over TDK here. And they join one of the five other teams that won in one of the standings.
Yeah, and I have to say, Altec played this game very well on Jinx. Throughout all the chaos, he was able to keep himself farmed, keep himself quite safe as well. 3-1-7, 474 CS in a 42-minute game.
Yeah.
Is a very large number, and you could see the power of his Jinx coming through with some monstrous crits late in the game. Even to the Ninja Tabid, Zhonya's Hourglass, Vladimir, he was able to duel those out. So a very nice job there by the new acquisition for Gravity Altech.
Unfortunately, as we see, where we had seen TDK on the screen, Seraph in particular, the Vlad split push unfortunately didn't quite work for them. Couldn't get enough pressure down. The hard engages, the split up teams, something that Gravity seemed to be able to utilize quite well. Dive in the back line, blow someone up, continue on from there. The fact that their threats were just a little bit tankier, I suppose, helped a little bit in that.
Yeah.
Well, Haunter got to keep cleaning people up after the initial dive.
Yeah, and even harkening back to Champion Select, we talked about the range of the initiations for these teams. TDK was a relatively mid-range team, whereas Gravity was an all-in dive team, but their initiation came outside of the initial threat range of TDK. So you have the range in which TDK can do damage and the range in which Gravity can initiate. One is larger than the other, and it did end up winning because they were able to use their initiations at the right time.
Yeah, and a well-coordinated dive at the very end right there. We saw actually just, I think, a slightly improved game from Gravity, right? A lot of good rotations to the mid lane. They knocked those turrets down slowly but surely. Good job by them. Bunny Fufu making sure he had pulled aggro at the very end there just tanks the inhibitor turret. And even those things shred armor, they don't shred Alistar damage reduction. So actually, he's practically immune to the effects that thing even has on him. Allowed the rest of the team to funnel on in through. Even Move managed to make a really big play at the very end there, landing a long-range Q to execute, I believe, Latman under the Nexus itself. And did just enough for Gravity to win.
For as squishy as Move was, he did end the game 5-4-8, so victory for Gravity.
Second most kills on the team for the jungle Lee Sin. Props to Move, props to Gravity. For now, going to send it down to Riv, who's standing by on the red side.